Lead Time is a weekly dose of leadership insights and interviews from Tim Allman and Jake Bessling. Lead Time is for any leader living in a busy world, looking to be inspired, equipped, and empowered to lead others to their fullest potential. This is Lead Time.
Welcome back to Lead Time. Tim Allman here with Jake Bessling and our friends Bill and Christy Galtier. And you did a wonderful job last week talking about the first three stages. We'll summarize them really, really quick. Confidence in Christ. I'm going to see if I get it right here. All right. Helps in discipleship and responsibility in ministry.
You did it.
Is that it? All right. Cool, cool. So we're a simple church at Christ Greenfield. We're pastors at Christ Greenfield. Thanks for joining us wherever you are on your journey with Jesus. But we've made some connections about our simple discipleship journey. Live simply. We want people to be in worship. We want them to be in small groups, and we want them to serve. And right up front, it sounds really, really good. We can measure where people are on their journey, but there could be more. Jake, say more as it connects to Journey of the Soul.
Yeah, as I was reading your book, we had read another book called Simple Church. And like Tim said, our three things that we think people could live in their sweet spot of life spiritually with the help of the church would be worshiping in a community, serving, and also in a small group. Now, that's corporate kind of language, honestly. That's like, hey, at this church, simply do these things. And it's not so simple, but we're not asking you to do 50 things. And the thing I'm seeing is that I could be in worship, my heart's not right. I could be joining a small group because my spouse told me to, and I could be serving out of obligation. I like your book in that it's then on the individual level as I'm going through that sweet spot of those three, how I could self-measure how my maturation is really digging in there. So how does that resonate with you as you've written this book and then also read and interacted with a lot of other churches? Do you think there'd be some coalescing of those two ideas?
Yeah, so for instance, in worship, our understanding of God changes and grows
right.
as we move through the Christ stages. I mean, God's not changing.
Right.
It's like, you know, in the Chronicles of Narnia, the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and, you know, Lucy says, you know, to Aslan, Aslan, you're bigger now. And he says, well, actually, you know, it's like you're appreciating me differently now,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
and
that's
so,
great.
You know, in the beginning, God is our forgiver. Jesus is our Savior. And so, you know, as we go along, there's teaching that's coming in there and helping discipleship. And that's a different understanding. And then, well, God is our Lord and our Master. And, you know, we're stewards of these gifts that we've been given. And so that's going to be really important. I have this sense of accountability, like what's coming out of my life, what's the fruit. And then we've got this time of the wall. And it's like all the discombobulation that happens there. And God seems distant and far away, you know, where are you, Lord?
Do I really want to go to worship now? Can I really cry out to him with all this anguish or not?
Yeah, and is God really Emmanuel? Is God really with me? Is God really, you know, pure mercy and grace? And then we come into the inner journey, and it's like going back to the C stage, in a sense, in like maybe a second experience and falling in love with God all over again. There's this new intimacy with God that's developing. And so we discover, you know, Jesus is not only my Lord, he's my friend. And God is an Abba, a Papa. And then in Spirit-led ministry, there's this fresh anointing and a deepening in the Holy Spirit and our understanding of the Holy Spirit and living life in the presence of the Holy Spirit is such a big deal. And then in transforming union, it's like the Father, the Son, and the Spirit are three, but they're one, and I'm living in this community, and it's like I'm just in this mist all the time of God's presence, and I'm practicing God's presence. So just in that example of worship, there is a evolving or developing or growing of our understanding of God and God's bigness, and we don't lose the early images or understandings, but they develop and they flourish.
So wonderful. No, go ahead.
Well, and our way of worship changes as well. So when we first are in the C stage, we're learning to worship, it's really about music. It's being led to sing and learn these worship songs and get the words for it. And then as we move into help and discipleship, we're beginning to, as we're learning more about God and studying, and once again, our language for him is expanding, we're learning to worship him with our mind. Mm. And then as we go into service and responsibilities in ministry, we're learning to worship him in action and around us.
Your definition of worship now is expanding from an hour to Romans 12, a way of life, a sacrifice.
Mm-hmm. And then as we move into the inner journey, we're learning to worship God without words. And we're learning to recognize that we can be still and worship. And we're learning to, in the later stages, we're learning to appreciate and worship God in nature and his beauty in people and be enthralled with him. You know, more things are enthralling us with Jesus, and the worship is happening more naturally, more organically. It's not something we're having to decide and choose to do. I'm going to go on Sunday and worship. It's a part of our life. We do it unconsciously.
Let me get really practical then. Like, if we have 1,000 people worshiping in person and online, or wherever you are, 1,000 people, how best would you see taking that idea to the worshiper and having them see their maturation? Is it us making the decision? No. Is it us filling out the form? Is it them self-assessing? How could they see their maturity?
Well, I mean, it'd be super helpful for your church to have everybody take the Pathfinder surveys that are in Journey of the Soul and to get an idea what their home stage is in their faith and in their development, because you're probably going to have a clustering within your community. And so then that knows that you especially need to speak to that group of people.
Where is my church on the stages? Yeah, majority-wise.
You don't want to leave others out, so you want to know where other people are, and you want to be appetizing them for what's a stage ahead of them as well. And so something I love about the scripture and why in the Journey of the Soul book for each of the Christ stages, we have key scriptures that are just examples, and we could have picked hundreds for every stage, but there are certain scriptures, like there are certain worship songs that especially speak to the experience, the needs, and the challenges of particular stages. And so when you draw in those scriptures and then you highlight that the stage it's especially speaking to, or in your worship song selection, so people go on their Spotify playlist, we've got free playlists of 30 or more contemporary Christian worship songs for each of the Christ stages and the wall. And so it's right there. And so then we have found songs where the lyrics especially speak to the experience of a stage. And so you can mix those into your worship and maybe make a comment, you know, around that, so that if someone is, say, in the S stage of Spirit-led ministry, if everything in the church is programmed around our stage of responsibilities and ministry, they're going to feel left out. Now, there might be a lot more people in the R stage than the S stage, but if you don't want to lose those S stage people, because like you want to have them as your small group leaders and your mentors and, you know, your guides, it's like, okay, we need to speak to them too. And we need to think about, now, how do we do that? Now, some of that maybe comes into, like, in your small group ministry, maybe some of that's happening like on retreat, and we're doing a silent retreat. And somebody at the C stage might be like, that sounds weird to me. I don't know about that. Sure. But someone that's have been at the wall and done some inner journey work, it's like, I need that. I need some space of quiet. I need to be mentored in this, and I want more of this intimacy with God.
That's wonderful. We're smiling because you've done a lot of work for us. Thank you.
Yeah.
How do we now apply it and really just release it to the community?
And we're survey junkies, so that Pathfinder survey. Christ Greenfield, you will be getting that survey, and we will use it, and it will inform worship, small group, and service as we continue to go deeper. So let's talk about the wall. How do you define the wall? I'm going to share Gulick and Hagberg's journey, The Critical Journey. That was super, super helpful. And it's kind of a companion in many, as you and I talked a few months back, Bill. It's a wonderful starting point. You wanted to write this book because you're like, man, we needed to lean more into the confidence in Christ. You could lead into some legalism, but that journey, and I remember how they define it, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's kind of ego being built up, hitting a wall, and then kind of the ego on the second half of life being torn down, becoming less so that Christ can become more. But we don't hit that second stage apart from the wall. So how do you define that season of the wall?
Yeah, the wall, we really believe it evokes the inner journey. And so that's one of the big takeaways in our book, Journey of the Soul, is that the wall isn't just a wall. It isn't just a time of stuckness and spiritual dryness and God feels distant, or a time of burnout or a moral failing that I need to recover from. When we hit these walls and these stuck places in our journey with Jesus and we get disoriented, it's not that God has left us or is being mean to us or something. It's actually that the Holy Spirit is inviting us into a deeper place. And in God's grace and God's wisdom, the best way to help us go deeper is through that trial, through that difficult time, that is now evoking some feelings, some longings, some realization that I have some sin to confess. And so there's actually a great work of grace that tends to be hidden to us at the wall. And so if you learn the Christ Stages map, it takes things that are really complicated about the soul and relationships and emotions and faith and all this, and makes it really simple to say, okay, if you're at the wall, what that means is the Holy Spirit is inviting you to do some inner journey work.
Yes.
And so that means do some more, slow down and do some more reflecting on what you feel, what you're experiencing, what are the struggles or sins in your life, and trust that God is in that process, and it's going to take a while, but it's going to be good because it leads to a renewal.
The wall often involves a burnout, a sense of maybe a disillusionment or a doubt, a disorientation in your faith. It's not working the way I thought it was. You know, we kind of have this mentality early on, and even in Help and Discipleship, if I do A plus B, God's going to give me C. And then we realize, well, I can't actually control God and manufacture these things, and that's not actually the spiritual life, and it's not about me trying to control God to secure myself to get the outcome I want. But we kind of can start to think that it is when it's, well, God gives me these promises. If I do these things, he'll do this.
Right,
and
right, right.
And we get attached to that. And then when we enter suffering, or we start to experience pain, or we come to the end of our own abilities and just can't do it anymore, it can provoke this crisis for us. For me, when I hit a wall, it was because I was working with clients who were traumatized, who were in so much pain. These were good people. I loved them so much. And it hurt me so bad to be suffering with them. And I just kept crying out to God, God, these are your people. Why are you letting them suffer and be sinned against in such horrible ways? And I began to get angry at God. I began to come into this crisis of doubt of, God, are you even good? I mean, I know I've taught in the church that you're good and that you're loving, and I've ventured my whole life on this, but now I'm doubting it because I'm seeing so much pain and so much suffering. And it's rocking my world, and I've got three teenagers, and I'm saying that I trust you, and yet the reality is my life is showing I don't, because I'm worried. I'm really worried, and I'm trying to secure them, and I'm trying to protect them, and I'm not really trusting you, and I'm afraid to let go. And so it was this crisis of faith of, like, I've professed all these things. I've taught all these things. I've believed all these things, but my life is showing that I don't really, because if I did, I wouldn't be questioning your goodness and your love, and I wouldn't be trying so hard to secure myself and my kids. And it was a wall for me to have to realize, okay, am I really willing to let go and trust you? Am I willing to suffer for you? Am I willing to let my kids suffer for you? How much do I trust your love? And that was a wall for me, because all the things that have propped me up in my faith weren't enough anymore. Believing it because I'd been taught to believe it wasn't enough anymore. And I had to do some real deep soul work and inner journey work.
Thanks for sharing your story.
Yeah. I was going to ask then, because a lot of people might want to avoid the wall.
Mm-hmm.
Or I thought this Christian life wasn't supposed to have walls anymore. Mm-hmm. And you read the Psalms and it's all about walls.
Mm-hmm.
How is your life better? How is your spiritual life with Jesus better because you went through that wall?
So much better. Because what I did was I had to die to self and really trust that God would meet me with his love and his power, his grace, his favor, that it was enough at the bottom of me when I couldn't do anymore, when I was in desolation, when I had only negative emotions left and I didn't have the energy to do anything for God anymore, but just be with him and to let him minister to me and to be emotionally honest with myself, with God, and with other safe people. That was so key, because I had to realize I had needs, that my soul was sick, and that I needed some ministry myself, and to let the Lord pour into me and bring healing to some wounds that I had covered up and repressed because I was busy for God doing all these great things and good things and important things. And just to be still, to set boundaries, and to let the Lord pull me back to my abandonment wound as a baby when I was hospitalized because I had surgery to save my life.
Wow.
And to let him show me that that was a part of my life story, that he allowed that to happen because that was my sacred wound. And that the vision, as I let him heal me, was then I would be a wounded healer.
Mm-hmm.
And was I going to be willing to do the work of going back to that pain and trauma and let him bring his healing touch in my life? Was I going to be willing to just, if he never used me again, that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
I can be content in just being his.
Wow.
And some of the things like that gets done in the inner journey work.
So you can't.
So worth it.
You can't go on that journey alone.
No.
There's not a chance. Isolation is deadly.
That's right.
At this point. And so was there someone or a group of people who came alongside you?
Yes, there were. There were a number of things that really helped me with that. One was books like Journey of the Soul that articulated my experience.
Yeah.
Because it feels like I'm alone.
Words.
Nobody's talking about this. Nobody else is experiencing this. Everybody's going to church and looking happy and worshiping and teaching, and they all have faith. What's wrong with me? I'm doubting, you know? And so there's shame in that. And so unfortunately, a lot of Christians exit the faith at the wall because of that shame, because of that not having the words, not understanding what's happening, the opportunity that's there at the wall. And so thankfully, Bill had been through the wall before me, and he was in Inner Journey and Spirit-led ministry, and I could see the renewal in him, and so that gave me hope. It was like at the time I couldn't believe. I saw being lived out right next to me the reality and the hope of there's more for me after the wall. And, of course, he was praying for me, and so that was very helpful, too. I started meeting with Jane Willard at that point.
Oh, wow. Dallas Willard's wife?
Yeah.
I remember,
yeah.
Wow.
If you don't know
who Dallas Willard is, look him up. And his wife is a rock star,
she
too.
She is. Yeah, Dallas and Jane have been great mentors for us. Learning from Dallas and Jane has been huge. Jane also is a marriage and family therapist like I am. And so, you know, I called her up and I said, I need to meet with you. And she said, no, you live too far from me. It'll take you too long. Find somebody close to you. And I said, well, I'll see, but I think God's telling me to meet with you. And I was asking the Lord, did I hear you wrong? Because it was like a 5-hour drive from our house with LA traffic. But it was only 87 miles. And God said to me, if Mary can go 80 miles on foot to be with Elizabeth, you can drive 80 miles to meet with James. So I started taking a day just to drive up there, meet with her, and come back and take the whole day. And she was there for me. She understood all of this. And she also is gifted in healing prayer. So she did some healing prayer for me back with that abandonment wound. Wow. And so she was pretty key in being there for me at my bottom as well. And then just the ancient writers articulate this a lot. St. John of the Cross, give wording for it. A lot of the spiritual formation world and that language starts to get this. And we were learning that. We were training in spiritual formation at that point, too. So all of that was really helpful and supportive to me.
So you mentioned some influencers.
Mm-hmm.
Who are some others? We mentioned Nouwen, last week.
You said Wounded Healer.
He is a wounded healer. Right? Yeah. Nouwen is great. Eugene Peterson is a great source. Yeah.
We draw on Teresa of Avila,
mm-hmm.
who we call Teresa of Jesus, because that's another of her names. But we look to her as like a spiritual mother throughout the book. And so our model ties into her model of the interior castle and the mansions of the soul. And so just, giving some language for that.
Tell us.
I would say also, though, having help and a mentor and people to companion you on this is important. But crucial also at this time is being able to spend some time in solitude.
Yes.
And that was especially important for me because I needed to disconnect from all these voices and all these pressures and all these people I was trying to please in order to get in touch with my soul and find my soul, and in order to be able to get in touch and actually hear God for myself.
From God, that's wonderful. You mentioned, as you go to your story, y'all mentioned 6 types of walls. You kind of alluded to it, but I just wanted to say them. Burnout, spiritual burnout, blowout, moral failure, personal crisis, disease, family problems, grief, faith crisis, disbelief or cynicism, and dark night of the soul, ongoing spiritual dryness. So as you look at those 6, which one have you gone through? What's your big wall?
Yeah, well, most of those.
We ain't got all day.
which one would you want to talk about?
Well, I've hit the wall 3 times.
Yeah.
And
by the way, it seems like spiritual Spartan right now. Yeah. We have this wall with fire, and we're going to get over it with Jesus.
Yeah, and it illustrates, we were talking in the last podcast about the roadblocks at each of the Christ stages, and we'll come back to this, the second half of the journey in the next podcast. But each stage has a different roadblock, and that roadblock could become a wall. So you can hit the wall at any stage. Good. We put the wall in the middle because the most common place we hit it is in midlife and after some years in the R stage of responsibilities and ministry. Now, we have some old souls amongst us who before midlife might hit the wall and do this deeper journey. And so that was true for me at age 20 in a job. I was an apprentice butcher, which was a great job for making money, but the butchers didn't think it was a nice thing for a college kid to be working their job to make money and not really learn the trade for the long term. And so they treated me pretty badly, and I had a dark night of the soul in that job where, you know, God, where are you? Why would you let me suffer like this? I don't understand. How can you be loving? And you know, I'm trying to be a witness for you because I know you want me to be a Christian witness here, but I'm just depressed and discouraged. And so that was a really disorienting, discombobulating thing for me. I didn't have the language of the dark night of the soul. So it wasn't until later that I figured that out, and God helped me through that. And then in my 30s, I hit a wall of burnout from overworking as a counselor and as a pastor. And I was for God, and I was relying on myself more than I thought. I had more ego in there. And so I collapsed just emotionally. There were many things in my life that were still going well, but my career was depressing for me. And so that, again, I was another, you know, psalmist. You were talking about the psalms and the wall. It was, you know, God, where are you? And I lost my desire for God, and I was very disoriented. The third time I hit the wall was more recently, and it was around the growth of our soul shepherding ministry. And I was hitting this leadership lid as our organization was growing, and I was taking on some different roles to help us grow and to follow the Lord in this. And battling with a lot of inadequacy and judgment and tiredness and struggling with this. But this time, unlike the first two times, I had this map. I had the Christ Stages map, and so I knew, okay, this is a wall. I've been here before, and what's happening is the Holy Spirit is inviting me into the inner journey. I need to get out the shovel. That's the symbol for the I stage, the shovel. I need to do some digging. What am I feeling? What are my inadequacies? What is this guilt and this shame? Where is this coming from? And, well, this isn't of God. And talking to a soul friend or a mentor about this to work that through and finding God in that. And so at this third wall, I never, like, lost my way or got depressed or didn't really get stuck. I was stuck in a localized way. But because I had the language and I had the support that I needed, I was able to walk it through with Jesus.
Wow. That's just want to sit in the midst of that for a moment. I mean, you just shared like very vulnerable stages of your life. And for me, I resonated with that early 20s. I was about 26 and got into church work, and it was a dark night of the soul when you thought it was one thing and you uncover it's a bunch of sinners, including yourself,
yeah,
that don't always have it together, but don't always also talk the way y'all both did, mm-hmm, of the transparency of your failures and flaws and habits and hurts and hangups,
yeah,
and really struggled. And until I met Tim and some other leaders as I was going through that journey to say, not all pastors are bad. Like, you can really get myopic on, mm-hmm, on like just seeing the hurts that you have. And I was hurt by a few just different pastoral leaders fighting.
Mm.
That I forgot all the other good pastors I had seen before that also are sinners, but humbly were confessing that. And it was interesting to then, as you got built back out of that by Jesus and others, whose presence, like Tim in my life, were just like, hey, a peaceful presence of love and support. Thank you, brother.
Love you.
Of, we're gonna get through this together. And then you start seeing in a different light, like, wow, I was really not seeing the whole picture in that pit, because you can't in a pit. You can only see like a little bit of up, and then you, mm-hmm, get out of it and you're like, wow, that's how bad it was. Mm-hmm. But that's how good, yeah, Jesus is,
yeah,
to draw us out of that. So just want to honor y'all's story and appreciate that.
Well, thank you. And what these stories are illustrating, yours as well, is that at the wall, there's a particular spiritual discipline that we need that's like critical, and that's talking with a spiritual director or a soul friend, a mentor, a pastor. And that's valuable in any of the stages, of course, but at the wall, it's critical. It's like you're probably not going to get through that trial, that experience, that stuckness, if you don't have somebody that's going to really listen to you and support you and pray for you.
Slower.
Yeah, slow it down, yeah. And find those words, like you were saying earlier, Tim, finding those words to describe our experience and where is God in this, or it feels like God isn't in this.
Mm. Yeah. Pastors are best when we recognize we're wounded healers. Mm-hmm. And we can't take people someplace we haven't been. And so we get to the privilege of modeling dependence upon Jesus, upon the Holy Spirit, being carried along, and then even being vulnerable at those places of, I mean, we got a captive audience every single week, and now between the weeks, to just say we're human beings that are that are broken. So for the pastor, the leader that's listening and saying, I feel like the entire thing is just, I'm disappointing. I've said this before. I'm disappointing people at a rate they can handle, but I don't know if I can handle it. The amount of difficulty and trauma in we're a soft target, you know, for a lot of people who have come up to the wall and don't recognize that it's only Jesus. And they look to us to be Jesus, you know, and we're a part of the body. We are not the head. He has to be the head. So any words of wisdom and care for pastors who may be there right now?
We talk to pastors all the time in soul shepherding, and it's hard to be a pastor, especially in America. It's hard to be a pastor and not be in the R stage because there is so much work to do, and even the work of just developing leaders who can help you do the work. There's a lot of responsibilities that we carry, and especially in the American church and the expectations that we all have for church and for worship services and all this. And so it's hard to not be in this stage where we're just caring so much and we're feeling so much for the people and we're carrying these burdens. And so, yeah, at some point we hit that wall and we need to be humbled and we need to have that ego deconstruction that you were referring to, Tim. That happens at the wall if we will let the Spirit of grace do his work so that we can be remade, reformed from the inside out. Mm-hmm. And that's going to happen especially through things like praying the Psalms that are giving us, again, language for what we're experiencing and finding God in that, and through talking with a spiritual director, a soul friend, through things like Christy was modeling with solitude and silence and getting some quiet space, because that helps us to disentangle ourselves from the world and from other people and get alone with God and learn to hear God's voice. And so at each of the stages and at the wall, there's different disciplines that are likely to be most helpful. And so that's one of the big takeaways of Journey of the Soul, is helping people understand that, and especially helping pastors and leaders and disciplers and soul friends. When you care for other people, when you can have, first of all, the language to describe what they're experiencing, but then second of all, some ideas about where they might need to go in scripture and in spiritual practices, because the needs of the soul are different in these different stages.
And it's been tailored to their stage then, that you've done the homework to say, this is what that stage needs. As we close here, Christy, what story in scripture do you resonate most with of someone hitting the wall?
Well, certainly David,
yep.
King David, you know, and actually Joseph too. I mean, his Pharaoh's wife's betrayal, or his brother's betrayal was a wall. Pharaoh's wife, you know, betrayal was a wall.
He does the right thing. I've honored you, God, and then I'm in jail.
Yeah, and then, you know, being in jail for so long and even not remembered, when, you know, after interpreting the dreams, another wall there. I think every great leader, if you look at their lives, we go through in the book, Abraham's journey through all the Christ stages, Paul's journey through all the Christ, Jesus's journey through all the Christ stages. You know, if you look at any of our biblical heroes in their lives, you can see this and how they had to persevere through that wall and learning to wait on the Lord and be surrendered and not try to make things happen themselves, and learning to wait for the Spirit. Even that story I love of David and Samuel, where God tells him not to go to war, but to wait to the wind of his Spirit till he hears it in the balsam trees before he moves out. And when he waits and he moves out, they're victorious. But then there's other times when he doesn't wait and he steps out in his own strength and they get defeated. And so I think those are good examples, you know, for us as leaders.
Reading a book right now called Leap Over the Wall.
Oh, yeah.
Eugene Peterson.
Yeah, Eugene Peterson came out in 97. Yeah. Uh-huh. Dusted it off and really, really enjoying. Yeah. It's David's journey connected to Jesus's journey. And you're exactly right. Lots of walls.
Yeah, but I also want to just say too, in response to what you shared about being a pastor, it is so hard, and pastors need somebody who can have empathy for them and how difficult it is as well, and the burdens that you're bearing and the possible standards, you know. So we need empathy.
Thank you.
Yeah,
we appreciate y'all's time. We got one more of these coming up. If you missed the last one, go back and watch it. As we close with this one, what were other words you might have used instead of the wall? Did you have any other ones? Or was it like, it's going to be the wall?
Yeah, well, I mean...
That's a good question.
Stuckness, dryness, but yeah, it I mean, I read the book Leap Over the Wall, and so that's come right out of Psalm 18.
Okay.
Yeah. So I've understood that for a long time. That sweet metaphor of for we're on a journey, but we hit a wall. So.
Well, and you're a marathon runner.
I'm a marathon
runner.
And
you've hit the wall physically.
Running 9 marathons, 26.2 miles.
I've seen him hit the wall.
You hit the wall. So you're right. That's probably the main reason why I picked that.
I can relate. Now, I've run one marathon and one only, and I hit the wall way earlier at 18 than I thought. So, but Jesus and my wife and a lot of other encouragement, Chicago Marathon got me through. Really, the cloud of witnesses, the 2 million people along the side, keep going. Keep going.
Yeah, I love that.
Keep going.
Yeah.
Keep going. So you keep going too as a leader. And what you heard here is that your people, the people you're leading, the people you're discipling yourself, need to be fed, need to identify that wall in their life, have other people pouring into them. Jesus is right there to carry them over the wall, get them out of the pit, and get them to finish the race strong. Thank you so much, Bill and Christy, for being here. We'll see you next week on Lead Time. Sharing is caring. Come back for the third part of 3 with Journey of the Soul. Peace.
Later. Thanks, Bill, Christy.
You have been listening to Lead Time with Tim and Jake. You can subscribe on your favorite platform where you listen to podcasts, or by visiting christgreenfield.church/CGTV. Thanks for listening. Tune in next Friday for another episode of Lead Time.